Welcome, Grace Chapel. It's good to have you back joining us for another edition of the Jimmy and Joe Show. Always good to be in the studio.
Are we really going to? We're not calling it that, are we?
No, let's don't call it that. What do we want to call it?
I don't know.
He's Jimmy, I'm Joe.
I don't know what to call it. The read the Bible and get into it video thing.
Okay. All right. So, well, why don't we start with reading the Bible? That's what are you going to read this morning?
It'll keep us a little more focused this morning.
Okay. Good
Luke
luck.
Luke chapter 12. Okay. Starting in verse 22. And this is Jesus speaking. And he said to his disciples, "Therefore, I tell you, do not be anxious about your life. What will you eat, or nor about your body, what you'll put on? For life is more than food, and the body more than clothing. Consider the ravens, they neither sow nor reap. They have neither storehouse nor barn, and yet God feeds them. Of how much more value are you than the birds? And which of you, by being anxious, can add a single hour to his span of life? If then you are not able to do as small a thing as that, why are you anxious about the rest? Consider the lilies, how they grow. They neither toil nor spin, yet I tell you, even Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed like one of these. But if God so clothes the grass, which is alive in the field today and tomorrow is thrown into the oven, how much more will he clothe you? O you of little faith, and do not seek what you are to eat and what you are to drink, nor be worried, for all the nations of the world seek after these things, and your Father knows that you need them. Instead, seek his kingdom, and these things will be added to you."
Okay, so there's a couple of things that jump out in this, Jimmy.
Hold on, there was one more line.
Oh, I thought you were through.
I'm sorry. "Fear not, little flock, for it is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. Sell your possessions and give to the needy. Provide yourselves with money bags that do not grow old, with treasure in the heavens that does not fail, where no thief approaches and no moth destroys. For where your treasure is, there will your heart be also."
Okay.
Sorry, I almost missed that.
All right. Well, good. A couple of things that jump out at me. He's addressing anxiousness or anxiety a couple of times in there.
Yeah.
And especially as it regards to the basics of human life and survival. And one thing that I think about is that there's a lot of anxiety in our world today. We see it even among the youngest. Experiencing anxiety maybe as never before.
Right.
Speak to that a little bit about why you think people are so anxious and how this passage addresses that.
Yeah, well, I have an opinion about it.
I
don't know whether I'm right.
Well, we value your opinion.
This
so
is just my opinion,
it.
But okay. I believe, you know, it's strange that people are more anxious than they've ever been, considering we have more food and clothes than we've ever had. So it's almost like Jesus is talking to people who don't have access to the next day's food or clothing, and you know, our closets are full and we need to throw away half of the stuff that we have. Like, to really live maybe a free life would probably be good for us to get rid of half of the garbage we've collected.
Yeah.
So why are we more anxious? And that's where I feel like the two parts of this passage go together, is like, don't store up for yourself, right?
Right.
With every possession that we collect, with everything that we have, it increases our anxiety. It increases our anxiety to have more and more and more things. Because we have to manage those things, and we're responsible for those things. So I believe that we all have an inherent sense that we should be good stewards of what we have. And the more we have, the more anxiety we have, because we're wasting it, we're storing it.
We're scared we're going to lose it.
I mean, the storage industry is a $1 billion industry, because people have more stuff than they can stuff in their garages, so they need an extra space that they rent to stuff more stuff. It's insane.
That is insane.
I mean, it's a really huge growing business. It's just places to stick your stuff. So what's bizarre to me in this passage in particular is, you know, when Jesus says, seek first the kingdom, I feel like he's opening the door to a whole different way of thinking about stuff.
Right.
And, you know, because remember, the kingdom is God's rule and reign. And if you were to seek that first, then the other things will be added. That doesn't mean everything's going to go well for you if you seek the kingdom.
Yeah.
And it doesn't mean that everything's going to go badly for you necessarily. So it's not really about your stuff. It's about something else. And so, you know, in classic Jesus form, he's changing the conversation. He's saying, don't worry about this. Don't worry, you know, don't do this. Instead, do this. So what are those three things? Don't store up,
right?
Do, not worry, right?
Right.
And then the third piece was seek the kingdom.
Right. But, you know, it's as part of this conversation, what is it's almost mystical about, there's something about seeking the kingdom that removes anxiety even in your most difficult days and challenges. It rises up within us a trust, a level of trust that God will provide. Mm-hmm. And that provision can take on many different appearances.
Right.
You know, we've all experienced giftings that we weren't expecting just at the right time. And sometimes it may be food in the hour we need it. Sometimes it may be a job opportunity in the time we need it. Sometimes it may be, I'm taking everything away from you so you can sit back and get to know me a little better.
Yeah.
I mean, it's endless the way that God blesses us. And I don't know about you, but in my personal experience, it's oftentimes in ways I had no idea. I didn't see it coming.
Yeah.
You know, I was focused thinking, well, it's going to be here, and here comes the curveball, and he goes, no, I'm going to bless you in another way. But I think the key to all of this is focusing on the kingdom and learning to trust God with everything. It's easy to talk about trusting God, but you know, if we're really honest with ourselves, do we?
Right. And what you're talking about is blessed subtraction, right? Because there's blessed addition, which is, you know, you have more than you thought you were going to. Mm-hmm. But blessed subtraction sometimes is something is taken away. And on the front end, you look at it and you think, well, this is bad. This is really bad. And I'm not going to make it. You know, mm-hmm. It's that feeling. I mean, I remember when my dad his business went bankrupt and we lost our home. Mm-hmm. I was about 10. And, you know, my whole world's blowing up. And somebody found out that we were in need and left groceries on our front step. And that's why my parents went to church. And so you just think about the addition that happened to our family, the radical shift in our lives that happened as the result of us not succeeding.
Right.
Like the trajectory we were on, we've been very wealthy. Mm-hmm. And successful. And instead, we were not wealthy. We were renting. My dad had to change careers. Everything was turned upside down. But we were blessed beyond measure.
Right.
With things we didn't really see the fruit of for years and years to come. Mm-hmm. And so it is kind of hard sometimes to sort out what is abundant life. Is abundant life necessarily always success? I would say no.
Okay.
Because when I did private practice for a while in northern Idaho, all my clients were millionaires. They were miserable. Like it did not decrease their anxiety or mental, you know, health struggles mm-hmm. to have more. And maybe that's just because those are the only people that can afford to go to counseling. but I really did notice it was a huge burden. To have a lot. And so just things aren't what you expect in the kingdom. I guess is what I'm thinking there. Have you ever had something like that? You know, as we're talking about this, does any stories from your life kind of come to mind?
Yeah, I mean, Beth and I have shared with our children some of our early experiences when we were first married and everything, and when we trusted God and went off to graduate school, to seminary at ORU, and without jobs, without anything, and new baby while we're there. In fact, we had both of our children while we were in grad school, and we can remember the cupboards running out and not having any food and wondering where the next meal's coming from, and like your dad, your story with yours, I mean, I remember vividly a knock on the door and opening the door, and there's two sacks of groceries at the front door, and that got us through to the next source of income, and you know, finally found some part-time employment that allowed me to work as well as go to school. And Beth was a stay-home mom with a newborn baby and all that kind of stuff. And so, yeah, we've got story after story of how God came through at times like that. And so, learning to trust is not easy. Yeah. And it is very challenging. That's why I say it's easy to talk about it, mm-hmm. say I trust, I believe, but how, what do your actions show that?
Right, and it gets tested.
You know, that's interesting too, because that's something we don't talk about much when it comes to our relationship with God. He's just that loving Father who always meets our needs and all that. But the loving fathers test.
They challenge their kids.
Mm-hmm. They want them to grow. They want them to learn and become mature, and so they do the things necessary for that to take place. Well, he's no different.
Yeah, what kind of parent would he be if he never put us through anything hard?
Right.
You know, it's like you want your kids to do difficult things, challenging things. You know, I always celebrate when my kids fail, and we make a big deal of failure because it's so important. It's such a crucial part. You know, it's like, all right, good job. You tried a thing and it went bad. Right? Instead of trying to sugarcoat it, you know, and be right. Like, well, it wasn't so bad. And, you know, I just feel like that, you know, if you believe you have a good father and you live in the kingdom, then you can trust the fact that whatever's coming your way, he's in the midst of it and there's something going on. Sometimes the lean times, sometimes the difficult times, sometimes the failure times mm-hmm. are where you grow the most. And so from a kingdom perspective, blessed are the poor mm-hmm. in spirit, because they will inherit what?
The kingdom.
Yeah. So lots to talk about. This will be a fun discussion in our groups. So grateful that we get to do this, that we get to talk about the kingdom together and think about what is real abundance. I think we have a lot of challenges here mm-hmm. to think through and ways that we can be generous to our neighbors and our friends and others in ways that with things we don't need to keep mm-hmm. And things that cause us anxiety we can get rid of. So I would say, you know, and I'm really poor at this, is going to God and going, what are you doing with me? What do you want me to get rid of?
Yeah.
What am I pursuing that's a waste of time?
Right.
What do I need to, what is really abundance here? And what am I missing out on because I'm pursuing the wrong things? And that's that kingdom adjustment mm-hmm. that I think we constantly need. And you know, I want to pursue that more and be more desperate to hear from God on those things. And I'm hoping everybody in our groups does the same thing.
Wow. Great questions. And I think that's a fantastic approach is for us to start asking each other and ourselves those questions and having discussion about them. Very good. Well, there you go. Another great time and great discussions. Enjoy as you get together and discuss these topics. God bless.